صل على نبي صلي على محمد صلي على حبيبنا صلي على محمد.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. In the Islamic calendar, Muharram is a month of special significance, but unfortunately, it can also be a time of social unrest in parts of the Muslim world. What is the significance of this month? What incident took place? And are there any special ways of observing this month? To discuss this further, I'm joined on my left-hand side by Shehzad Ahmed Sahib, who is the Associate Editor for the Review of Religions, and also Ayaz Mahmood Khan Sahib, who works in the Publications Department for the Ahmadiyya Muslim Community. Welcome to the program. Ayaz Sahib, can I start with yourself? Can you tell us a little bit more about the significance of the month of Muharram?
Absolutely, Kaleem Saab. The month of Muharram is the first month of the Muslim calendar, the lunar calendar, rather. And this month has, of course, it's the beginning of the new year, according to the lunar system. But it also has special significance spiritually as well, and not just in Islam, but also in other religions as well. It is recorded that fasts, the Jewish community would fast on the 10th of Muharram, and the Arabs also used to fast during this month as well. When the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, migrated to Medina on one occasion, he noticed that the Jews specifically fasted on the 10th of Muharram. So he asked why they were fasting on the 10th of Muharram, what was the significance to them, and they said that they fast on this day because this was the day that Moses, peace be upon him, was successful, and the Israelites were freed from the despotic rule of the Pharaoh of that time. And the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said something very beautiful, very touching. He said that, well, then I have an even closer relationship to Moses, that even more so than you. I feel that I'm closer to Moses, and I will also fast on this day. So he also used to fast on the 10th of Muharram. Of course, then when Allah the Almighty prescribed the month of Ramadan and fasting in the month of Ramadan, then the Holy Prophet of Islam said that this is our first obligation as instructed by Allah the Almighty. And anyone who wishes to fast on the 10th of Muharram is also free to do so as well. So this is a month of special significance, not just in Islam, but in other religions as well. And it is a month which, of course, is also significant in the sense that a very tragic event is tied to the month of Muharram, a very tragic incident, which was the incident of the martyrdom of the grandson of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Hazrat Imam Hussein, took place. So Muslims throughout the world commemorate that tragic event, remind themselves of that tragic event, and pray for the children of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his progeny, and of course they commemorate it in different ways.
Shehzad Saab, can you tell us a little bit more in terms of the background of that martyrdom? There's a term that we commonly hear, Ashura. What is Ashura? And set the scene. Tell us what was happening at that time in the Islamic world.
Jazakallah, Kaleem Saab. So Ashura essentially is an Arabic term which quite literally means the 10th. And it was on the 10th of Muharram that Ayaz Saab has just mentioned as well, that this tragic event took place in fields of Karbala, where the beloved grandson of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Hazrat Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and many devout companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the members of the blessed household of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, were martyred. I think a good starting point in terms of its broader context will probably be to start with the institution of Khilafat, that was established after the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him's demise. The Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, has prophesied this, that after him will be Khilafat ala min Haji Nabuwa. The Holy Quran mentions of this and speaks about its lofty and noble status and the works of the Khalifa. But the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, also had prophesied that this Khilafat, i.e. the Khilafat on the precepts of prophethood, was only going to remain for a certain number of years, for 30 years in fact. He had prophesied in another tradition as well. And we see, if we look through the history of Islam, we find that after the martyrdom of Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was the fourth caliph and the last of the rightly guided khulafa, this institution of khilafat on the precepts of prophethood, i.e. khilafat ala min haji nabuwa, came to an end. Thereafter, there was a difference of opinion amongst the Muslim as to how the leadership in the Muslim ummah was going to continue and what form it was going to take. Hazrat Imam Hassan radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was the grandson of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, and the brother of Hazrat Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was elected by the people to take lead and become the Amir. However, he withdrew from the leadership in favor of Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was a companion of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And although this is in stark contrast to the action of Hazrat Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala anhu, which we will discuss further in the program, but the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam has said that although both actions are very different, but they both have committed a very noble deed, because your actions and deeds are judged by your intentions. And his intention was that to prevent any discord or bloodshed in Islam, because obviously after the period of Khilafat Rashida, the opponents of Islam and the Munafiqeen were always looking at opportunities to take advantage of the situation and cause harm to the Muslims. So for this noble cause, he withdrew his leadership in favor of Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu.
So Iyasab, who was Amir Muawiyah?
So Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu anhu was the son of Abu Sufyan. So if we just go back a bit, the genealogical chain, just to put things into perspective, we have Abdi Manaf, and Abdi Manaf had two sons, Hashim and Abdi Shams. From Hashim, the son of Hashim was Hazrat Abdul Muttalib. One son of Hazrat Abdul Muttalib was Hazrat Abu Talib. And Hazrat Abu Talib was the father of Hazrat Ali. And then, of course, Hazrat Imam Hassan and Hazrat Imam Hussein were the sons of Hazrat Ali. Hazrat Abdul Muttalib had another son as well, who was Hazrat Abdullah. And we know that Hazrat Abdullah was the father of our master and chief, the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So I mentioned there was two sons of Abdi Manaf. The second son, that was the line of Hashim, but then we had Abdi Shams as well. So Abdi Shams had a son named Umayyah, and the son of Umayyah was Abu Sufyan. And then the son of Abu Sufyan was Amir Muawiyah. And then in the context of this discussion, one of the sons of Amir Muawiyah radiallahu anhu was Yazid.
And as I was saying, Hazrat Amir Muawiyah, during his lifetime, appointed his son Yazid as the heir apparent, that after him, he will become the leader. And he also took the Pledge of Allegiance from all the governors and the officers in the region within the Islamic Empire. And I think this is the point of contention here, that when Hazrat Amin Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu passed away, Yazid ascended as the Amir, and he asked for all the governors and all the Muslims to take bayt, pledge allegiance to him. Hazrat Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala anhu and various other prominent companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, including Hazrat Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Hazrat Abdullah bin Zubair radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they refused to take the bayt. And Yazid also sort of forced them to take bayt, and even instructed the governor of Medina at the time to make sure that they take the bayt, but they didn't, and they migrated from there and went back to Mecca. the reason why Hazrat Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala refused to pledge allegiance, I feel is very important to mention here in the context of what then led ultimately to the tragic event of Karbala. And that is that in Islam, the principle, the underlying principle in terms of leadership is that the affairs of the Muslims are decided through mutual consultation. And even electing a leader is done through that. Allah the Almighty says that إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ أَن تُؤَدُّ الْإِمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. This is that the believers, they are entrusted with a responsibility that they must vote for those who are most eligible. And at the same time, it says وَأَمْرُهُمْ شُورَ بَيْنَهُمْ, that their affairs are done through mutual consultation. But in the case here, it was the complete opposite. Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu had appointed directly in his lifetime Yazid. And so this is the point that Hazrat Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala anhu refused to do the bath. And so he migrated towards Makkah and said that he will not be doing that. And then obviously it leads on to the other events.
Jazakallah Shazad Sab. Hey Asab, can you now summarize this in simple words in chronological order?
So as Shahzad Sahib has very eloquently explained, after the demise of Hazrat Ali, Khilafat-e-Rashida comes to an end. Hazrat Imam Hassan received the bayt of over 20,000 people. He withdrew his name from leadership at that time for Amir Muawiyah, radiallahu anhu, to prevent bloodshed and discord amongst the Muslims. Amir Muawiyah then appoints his son, Yazid, to be the next ruler after him during his lifetime. And Hazrat Imam Hussein and other prominent companions disagreed with this principle of hereditary rule. They did not accept this. They believed that according to the Holy Quran, leadership must be elected through a process of consultation, and the people have the right to elect their leader. And when Yazid, when Hazrat Amir Muawiyah passed away, Yazid then forced himself upon everyone and said that you must accept my leadership, pledge your oath of allegiance to me. And as a result of that, when that force came into Medina, Hazrat Imam Hussein and other prominent companions then moved to Mecca.
So Yasab, we know from the books of history that Hazrat Imam Hussein was martyred in the land of Iraq. What happens from Makkah onwards? Why did he go to Iraq? How did he get there?
That's a very important point, because a lot of people say that Hazrat Imam Hussein, God forbid, was hungry for power. He was thirsty for power, which is why he took this whole group of people to wage a war against Yazid, because he wanted power for himself, which is absolutely false. Nothing could be further from the truth. What happened is that the people in Kufa, when they understood, when they found out that Hazrat Imam Hussein disagreed with this concept of leadership and refused to take the bayt of Yazid based on that firm principle of consultation and election by the people, they started writing letters to him, the people of Kufa, and they said that please come to Kufa and take our bayt. And there, it is reported that there were thousands of people in Kufa who were ready to accept Hazrat Imam Hussein as their leader, so they invited him. And it was on their request that he went to Kufa, or intended to go to Kufa. But before going to Kufa, he sent Muslim bin Aqil to go and ascertain the state of affairs in Kufa. And when he went there, he received a very warm welcome. They were really happy that Hazrat Imam Hussein had sent his representative. And so Muslim bin Aqil then urged Hazrat Imam Hussein to also come to Kufa. So he then began his journey to Kufa. When he began moving to Kufa, people joined him along the way, people who supported his cause and people who agreed that this hereditary form of leadership, which is imposed by force, is un-Islamic, and Yazid's leadership is illegitimate, they joined him. When Hazrat Imam Hussein reached close to Kufa, he then, because there was no cell phones, there was no mobile forms of modern forms of communication, he didn't know what was going on in Kufa. But what happened in Kufa after he began his journey was that ultimately a Muslim bin Aqil, who was the representative of Hazrat Imam Hussein, he was mercilessly butchered and murdered. And then the leadership of Yazid began to find, pick and choose supporters of Hazrat Imam Hussein and execute and kill them as well. So there was bloodshed taking place in Kufa. But by that time, Hazrat Imam Hussein was already close to Kufa. It is narrated that when he reached Ashraf, at that place, Hur ibn Yazid then intercepted Hazrat Imam Hussein and said that, "I have been ordered to take hold of you and your party and not let you advance." And at that time, Hazrat Imam Hussein, if he was thirsty for power, he would have started to fight his war right there and then. But he repeatedly said that, "Look, these are the letters from the people of Kufa who have invited me. I've only come on their request. And if now the minds of the people of Kufa have changed, I will happily return to where I came from." But at that time, Hur ibn Yazid, he said that, "No, I have been ordered to keep you here, and you must accept Yazid, and you must do bet." And to that he refused. Then, and the month of Muharram had began at that time. Then the records demonstrate, and the historical account tells us that then Ibn Ziyad, who was the Amir of Basra, he sent a representative as well and sent instructions through him. And he came with instructions that, "We have been ordered to move the party of Hazrat Imam Hussein to a barren land where there is no food, there is no facilities, there is no water." And then they moved them to a barren land, which is known as the land of Karbala. So they were taken there by force. And then we read that further reinforcements were sent. Umar ibn Sa'd was sent by Yazid with an army of thousands. And then they surrounded Hazrat Imam Hussein.
And how many people were with Hazrat Imam Hussein at that time?
Before Hazrat Imam Hussein was intercepted by Hur ibn Yazid, he realized and found out about what had happened in Kufa and the murders that were taking place of his supporters and the executions and the blood of Hazrat Muslim bin Aqil. So he said, "Any of you who are free, who want to go, they can leave. I don't force anybody to stay with me, because now the events have changed. So if you feel that your life is in danger, you are free to go." So many of the people who joined him on the way, they left him. And he was primarily, it was the family members of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and close companions and supporters who were with Hazrat Imam Hussein. So Hazrat Imam Hussein had a small group of about 72 people. And these 72 people were now surrounded in a barren land by thousands.
And this included women?
It included women.
Children?
And children. And they were all sort of cornered in Karbala. And even at that time, Hazrat Imam Hussein repeatedly said that, "I'm not here to create any, I'm not here for war. If the people of Kufa do not want me to be their leader, I'm happy to leave." But they were forced there, to be there. And then it was through this last reinforcement which was sent that I just mentioned that then the torment and the brutalities and the torture began. They were denied water, they were denied food, and they were forced to accept Yazid. But Hazrat Imam Hussein remained firm and he said, "I will not bow my head to a despotic ruler, and I will stand for this principle, which is the principle of truth, that election is what brings about a leader in Islam, in the Islamic State." But then slowly but surely, of course, war was thrust upon them. And then it is narrated, it is a very touching and a very horrific scene that takes place in Karbala, very tragic, where the grandsons and the children, the progeny of Hazrat Imam, of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the children of Hazrat Imam Hassan and Hussein, fought valiantly in the battlefield, and they gave their life. They were just put into perspective that this was such a grueling and exhausting journey in the heat. That journey from Mecca to Kufa was a very long journey in the heat, and then they weren't given water, but they fought despite all of this. And of course, they were martyred one after the other. And then finally, Hazrat Imam Hussein, he also fought very bravely and very valiantly, it is narrated. When we put all of those events into perspective, it's very heartbreaking. It is said that a very cruel man, he took a spear and he threw it towards Hazrat Imam Hussein, and he was one of the last men standing, and that went through and pierced him in his chin. he was turning towards the river, Euphrates River. They stopped him. They didn't let him have any water. And then after that spear was hit towards him, he fell down. And then it is narrated that a very evil man, he came and he severed the head of Hazrat Imam Hussein. That blessed head, which the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to kiss. And there was absolutely, these people called themselves Muslims, but they perpetrated this barbaric atrocity against the grandson of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, about whom the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to pray repeatedly that, "Oh Allah, I love Hassan and Hussein. May it be so that you love them too." And particularly with regards to Hazrat Imam Hussein, it is narrated that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to lovingly and affectionately say that, "I am from Hussein and Hussein is from me." So then they didn't stop at this. They then, horses were brought and they trampled over the body of Hazrat Imam Hussein, crushed his ribs and his back. And then even that didn't satiate these barbaric, disgusting people. Then they went to the Muslim camp and there was women there. It is said that they tore off their veils and disrespected them and looted them. And this is the tragic event which took place at Karbala. And it is a tragic event which even now, when we think about it, we bleed, our hearts bleed. And we cannot help but feel an immense pain for these atrocities, these people who called themselves Muslims but had no respect and no consideration whatsoever for the beloved grandson of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that is what we remember, that sacrifice of Hazrat Imam Hussein in the month of Muharram. And it is that firm principle which we always remind ourselves of, that even if we have to lay down our lives for the truth, then we should be ready to do that.
Shahzad Sahib, these people were just not ordinary people. We're talking about the Ahlul Bayt. What does the term Ahlul Bayt mean? And why were these people so special to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi
wasallam? Kaleem Sahib, as El Sahib has so beautifully mentioned, the love the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, had for his grandsons, particularly Hazrat Imam Hussein and Hazrat Imam Hassan radiallahu anhuma. And then to know what's happened to their family, of course, it's extremely emotional to hear the account. And the Ahlul Bayt essentially are the family members of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. The Quran makes it very clear that the family of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, refers specifically to the wives of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him. The Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, has explained this as well further and said that the scope of the Ahlul Bayt is then further increased towards his children as well, towards his daughters, and then obviously his grandsons as well. So the Ahlul Bayt is the physical progeny and the family, the household of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, who had physical relation with him. But the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, in his lifetime, has also extended that in some respects as well, in form of the spiritual household as well. Some people were included in that as well. Of course, the whole ummah is included in the spiritual progeny of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him. But for instance, on one occasion, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Salmanu minna min Ahlil Bayt. The Hazrat Salman Farsi radiallahu ta'ala anhu is from among the Ahlil Bayt. And this actually is quite significant, because we find in the famous tradition of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that when the Quran mentions about the second advent of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in a spiritual sense, he placed his hand on Hazrat Salman Farsi and said that even if faith was to reach the highest star, someone from among them will come and bring faith back down. And of course, as we know, that has been fulfilled through the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam. And the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam has also been referred to as Salman, and has been mentioned in Tazkirah as well. This revelation has been recorded. So among the physical progeny, the Ahlul Bayt, as Ayasab has mentioned, but in the spiritual progeny, the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, the Imam of this age, is also included in that.
Jazakallah Shahzad Sahib. So many hundreds of years later, we even now feel that pain, and it's indescribable in terms of thinking of the torture, the killing that took place at that time. These events, or this event that took place, has shaped Muslim history since that time. And it's important that we remember that event, but it's important that we remember it in the right way as well. So on that tragic note, we're going to end today's program in terms of the way and the history that Hazrat Imam Hussein was tragically martyred and the effect that this tragic event had on the rest of the world and how it should be remembered. We'll look at this in our next program. So with that, we take your leave. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
صلي على نبينا صلي على محمد صلي على حبيبنا صلي